For those of you that arrived early, you got to hear my a little recording of the Buddhist monks chanting. You all heard this before. You probably be musicians, you probably have, but you know they sing in chords. Try it. I can't. I probably could do it today because I've got sort of a hoarse voice. But yes, thanks, Seth. It's really cool to be here. I love what you guys are doing in this class, and really appreciate the opportunity to sort of think back over some of the stuff that I've done over the years and kind of wondered whether it was relevant now. Seth, when did you start this program? How many years ago?
This program's been going for maybe 20 years, surprisingly. Oh, nice. I've been here for seven.
So. Seven, okay. Well, let's say sorry when you came.
Okay.
It's cool. It's really cool to see this. I think, you know, after my conversation with Seth, that there's a lot of stuff, there's a lot of overlap between what I've done and what I think you guys are up to now. So the monk chanting thing is relevant in terms of my personal history and kind of where my journey begins to some extent. When I was undergraduate, when I was your age, I was an anthropology major, and I went to Nepal to study ethnomusicology, of which you guys are probably all versed in that, but I had no idea really what it was. But I went there and I studied the sitar for 4 months and ended up with massive cramps in my legs from having to sit in the lotus position for 2 hours at a time. So the Buddhist monks there were temples in Kathmandu where you could go and you could hear them, you hear those wonderful bells. And so it sort of has always resonated with me. And you'll see that comes back throughout the course of the sequence of images I'm going to show you. So when I got to graduate school, the first artist that I really started looking at was this guy, Marcel Duchamp. He would be the gentleman towards the large glass there. And he was tremendously influential in so many ways in the art world. I think what inspired me most was, one, this notion of chance, right? You guys all talked about that a little bit. You drop marbles on the ground and they fall where they fall. They make noise, you know, certain noises. You don't have any control over it. So the large glass does two things. This was a piece that he worked on for, I think it was about 10 years between 1910 and 1920. And the fact that he was working on glass was his way of introducing to the art world. The art world is very different than the music world, what we call the fourth dimension. And basically what that meant was time-based work. And so the idea of it being on glass meant that everything that went on from the, you know, the light coming in the window to people walking around it and stuff like that became part of the piece, which of course he didn't have any control over. The other thing that's really significant about this piece in terms of this idea of chance is that he had sold the piece and it was sent to a show and it was crated. It came back to his studio at one point. He never thought he had finished it. And he opened it up and can you see the cracks in there? They go from the upper panel down into the bottom panel. So he opens it up and he goes, "Oh, it's finally done." And that was his way of sort of making a mark, I think, or establishing this notion that an accident can happen that can be really significant to the completion of a work. And what I've always found interesting, and we musicians and artists use the same language, right? We talk about tone, rhythm, those types of things. And in this particular case, you can see the lines, the you know, very fluid or almost organic lines connecting the upper panel visually to the lower panel. So if somebody were to draw this, for example, in an art class, they may make those exact same lines intentionally in order to establish a relationship between those two things. As far as I know, Duchamp didn't do anything with sound. He did this one piece, and it was called Ball. I think it was titled "Ball of Twine with a Sound, a Hidden Sound," and he put an object inside this. And you could pick the object up, you could pick the sculpture up, and you could shake it, and you could hear the object. But he loved secrets, and so he never told. To this day, nobody knows what the object is inside. And of course, us as viewers, we can't pick it up, so we don't have the opportunity to sort of try to discern what that might be. A group of artists followed him that were basically the group of artists that I was inspired by in the early part of my career, maybe if I was still sort of thinking about it, even now. Merce Cunningham, who is a dancer and choreographer. Any of you heard of him? Some of you maybe. You don't hear so much about him. You do hear a little bit about John Cage. You all know John Cage, right? He was doing performances and making sort of random sounds and doing strange things. There are some really good videos on YouTube of him, this being one of them. I think this was on the Ed Sullivan Show. Anyway, so he was one. He was really deeply influential to me. And then this guy, Robert Rauschenberg. And they were collaborating on things together. And I love this idea of sort of collaboration and group energy and sharing ideas and experimentation and trying new things. This is a performance piece that Rauschenberg did that was called Pelican. You could look up any of these people and see some amazing stuff. And I don't know that he ever did anything specifically. You see that cursor up there? Yes, you do. Specifically about making music or definitely making noise. But this was a particularly interesting piece to me. I believe this was done in sometime around 1970. And one of the things I understand that you're all interested in is technology and how you make interactive pieces using various types of technology. This is a piece he did called Mud Muse. And what he did is he had sensors, and you can see that big console over in the corner. That was a computer or control center. I doubt it was a computer. It's probably some kind of control center. And he had sensors in the room. And so the mud, which was made in a lab under very precise requirements, would bubble based on how many people were in the room. So if there was one person in the room, there'd be like one bubble. And if there, apparently at this point, there must have been 10 or 15 people somewhere around the room when that photograph was taken, because there's a lot of bubbles. So it created this really kind of funny and interesting collaboration between the artwork and the viewers and the audience that was in the room. I don't know what ultimately, I've seen that piece in the last 10 years. I'm not quite sure how the technology worked, but it must have had sensors that responded probably to movement that shot little blasts of air, which meant that it would have to have some kind of air compressor or something like that. And then the final artist here is this artist, Nam June Paik. Nam June Paik is famous for his video work and video installations that he did maybe starting around the 60s. He was an engineer. He invented what was called the video image synthesizer, which is a device, or was a device. I think we do this on our phones nowadays, but it abstracted imagery on the television and or on video. And Sony, the corporation, was so interested in it, they funded most of his career and gave him as many TV sets and all sorts of technology that he could use. And so one of the things that interests me, I picked this photograph specifically. It's not necessarily the greatest example of his work, but one of the things that we have to deal with all the time when we're working with technology is, what do you do with the technology, right? Do you hide it? Do you show it? And Nam June Paik was one of the first people. I'm going to show you another piece in a second. He was one of the first people who's like, let's embrace it, right? Why hide it? And you all know this if you're working with some of you are working with Arduinos, Raspberry Pis, that there's just something about these objects that is just beautiful. So you'll see here, the draping of the cords is, sort of partially by necessity, but also done intentionally as visual elements, kind of like what happened with the Duchamp piece. This is he worked with this woman, Charlotte Moorman. I think they were either in a relationship or married at some point in time. And they made this thing called the video cello, yeah, that was the name of it. And they do these performances together, which was sort of just an interesting kind of collaboration. I thought you'd enjoy seeing that. And then this artist, he wasn't really part of the group that inspired me. I liked his work. His name is Christian Boltanski. But look at the way that he's dealing with technology here. It's simple technology, and it's just light bulbs and electric wires, but the way he drapes them is just so beautiful. They don't look like tears. These are images of Jewish children who were killed during the Holocaust. All his work is very, very sad. So this is me. This is when I got in the game. I'm influenced by those people. I'm looking at what they're doing. This was 1982. They're all still alive at that point in time. except for Duchamp. And so I had this interest in kind of making music, random sounds. I made instruments for this particular performance piece. And we'd get in there and I'd drop marbles down pipes and hit the drum and all sorts of crazy stuff. I had hair dryers that you would turn on that would blow these sort of homemade wind chime things and stuff like that. In retrospect, I flat out loved this. But at the time I was so bad at it that you know, I didn't get any pats on the back for doing that stuff. So I threw the towel in on my performance career. This was one of the first pieces. There's something about water. I was going through these slides last night and I'm thinking, what is it? You keep coming back to water. What is it you like about it? I like the sound. I like the sound of a river. I like the sound of dripping. I like the sound of the shower. So this was a piece that I made that was, it was sort of an homage to a piece that Duchamp had made called Fountain, which was actually a urinal that he'd signed. You've probably all seen that. It's a very famous piece. And so I made a fountain, and the way that I did this is I put a very powerful pump in that basin, and it's something like 4 feet by 4 feet. And I hooked it up to a sprinkler, obviously put water in there and turned it on. And I had no idea what was going to happen. I thought it was going to leak all over the place. But it worked out really well, and I ended up with these just gorgeous circular patterns that made from the drops of the water, and the water would sort of expand out on the inside of the surface of that plexiglass box there and then drip back down into the trough there. And so you're definitely hearing the sound of the pump, but you're getting a lot of other stuff that's going on that's both visual and audio, right? So I like that. The first piece, and take note of what I'm doing with technology here. The first piece where I really tried to use audio as, you know, a significant part of the piece was this piece. It was called Point of View, and it was part of a residency program that I did up in Buffalo. It was on the Niagara River, just downstream from Niagara Falls, and it's a beautiful park there. And it's complex. If anybody has questions, if we have time at the end, if anybody has questions, I can answer them. But anyway, basically what I did was I made 12 of these phone booth looking things and placed them around this park at various places, where this one was kind of the worst of all of them because there was no view from that particular place. But we needed electricity. Electricity is just, back then, you know, batteries were horribly expensive and really not an efficient technology. So you needed 120 volts, and so you needed somewhere close to 120 volts. So that kind of affected some of the locations that we were in. What I did with the audio on this is, because this was a place where a public artist, and I wasn't necessarily a public artist, I was just a young artist who liked to do things out in public, that it was kind of a testing ground. And so when I, in my mind, sort of thought about, well, what really makes public art? I mean, we know on one hand, it needs to be objective so that our viewers can kind of read it and understand it. But what if I made public art that used the public as part of the piece? So I set up, these pieces were built on location. And so I set up a place where I had a recorder. This is all, everything was on tape back then. And it was, compared to what we have available to us now, it's just a horrible technology. So I had tape recorders set up in various places, and I would also walk around with a microphone and I would interview people, and I would ask them what they thought people should be thinking about. And that was an idea that continued to come back to me in various other pieces over the next couple of years. And the answers were, I don't know, everything from politics to, you know, what animal has the highest blood pressure. I mean, it was great. It was the whole gamut. And my problem as an artist is I'm always looking for something very specific. Like, I wanted this piece to be really political. And I wanted people to say, you know, we should be worried about the environment. We should be worried about nuclear war. And it didn't become that at all. And sort of, in a way, it was nice to be able to sort of let go of that. This is the piece in the anchorage of the Brooklyn Bridge. The anchorage is on the Brooklyn side of the bridge, and it's almost kind of like this room. It's these huge stones, gray stones. It's very damp, and it's very cathedral-like. You can kind of see it in that picture a little bit. You would have a field day in there. The next show you should do shouldn't be in Benson. It should be in the Anchorage or the Brooklyn Bridge. I mean, it's just an incredible space. You can't go wrong in there. And what I did, and this was very early in my career, I was working with projectors at the time. And there were only, I don't know, there were probably two or three artists at that point in time. This was like 1986, I think, who were doing work with projectors. The video projector was available, but it was too expensive for artists. And so I had made this, you'll see it in a couple slides, I'd made this projector that could project these large images. And so I projected them on the wall. They kind of look, this is Molly Ringwald. I don't know if you ever saw The Breakfast Club, but the piece was about the top 10 the top 10 young American folk heroes. I was very interested in folk heroes and their influence on people at the time. So I had these images of her and you know, Rob Lowe and all these people who were on that list at the time. They kind of came out of the wall like that. And then I had these phones that I set up. And these were kind of a primitive version of what you might have found in a museum of science at the time, where you'd pick up the phone and I found these big red buttons that were great. I don't even know where they came from, but you pick up the phone and you'd hit the recording. The recordings, I can't remember exactly what the recordings were from this. I used to find lists of things. I think this one might have been like theme songs. Oh, that's the next piece. Well, forget it. There were recordings. I can't remember exactly what they were, but this one will sort of illustrate what I was trying to do with the recordings. The problem with that piece is that it's an electric piece that's interactive, right? And unfortunately in this space, and I didn't know anything about electricity at the time, there was water dripping down from these big blocks on top. By the time I went to pick up the piece after the month-long show, everything was all rusted. That has the potential to be a very hazardous situation. So now I know better, I know to ground things, and I can wire things a little bit better than I did back then, but I got lucky. So here you see the same kind of rig with the phone. And this one was a piece, again, like I said, I like polls. I like factual information because artists were branded by doing these sort of whimsical things that just come from our imagination. I don't like that. I like it now, but I didn't like it then. So I found a poll where men between the ages of 24 and 35, I think was the age group, of which I was sort of right in the middle of at the time. Men were asked who they'd like to most spend the evening with, right? And this was USA Today or Chicago Tribune or something that this was published in. And my immediate response to this was, whoa, that's bad. Nobody should do that poll. That just to me just seemed very sexist. And then I thought, okay, well, based on who won it, maybe this would be kind of interesting as sort of a investigation into the psychology, the collective psychology of people in America, or at least that age group. So you can see, you might not recognize her, but over kind of in the middle right up there is Nancy Reagan. So men between the ages 25, 34 asked who they most want to spend the evening with. Nancy Reagan, who obviously Ronald Reagan was president at the time, she wins. And then it goes Nancy Reagan, Jane Fonda, Christy Brinkley, all these supermodels, which you would guess would be sort of the logical sort of response to that question. So what I tried to do with this piece, let's see if there's another picture. That's Jane Fonda in an American flag bathing suit. What I tried to do with this is I tried to figure out in my mind, because I was in that age group, what was I doing when I was a child? Remember, my undergraduate degree is in anthropology, so I have to ask all these questions. What was I doing when I was a child that would have made me think that way or respond to that poll that way? And I was watching TV. We were all watching TV. Any chance we had, we were watching TV. My parents were watching TV. And the song and the TV shows, not all of them, but some of them, had this kind of sexist agenda. And so what I did is I went back and I recorded all the theme songs from these TV shows, and I played them on the phone. So when you picked up the phone, like for example, you'd get to this one. It's a good picture. and you'd hit the button, I'm using that button again, you would hear the theme song to I Dream of Jeannie. If any of you heard that or seen that show, it's about a guy who keeps a woman in a bottle and she comes out and grants wishes, right? It's kind of sexist. And so you pick up the phone, you hear, I can't do it, but you all know that, I'm sure you've heard it. So you'd hear that. So the idea was sort of you juxtapose this information. The poll was presented on a card, so everybody who came into the show got to see the poll. Then they would see the imagery. Nobody was doing projection work at the time. So that whole component of it was very new to people. And then you would have to juxtapose it with something that most of the people at that point in time were probably very familiar with. So I got a little bit more political with this next piece. And you can see that the phones, after the show at Art Park, I was able to go get all the phones and I cut all the canopies off and stuff, and I kept that metal box. So all the technology in this case is kind of stuffed into this box, and there was either, a cord that came down that plugged in to outlets. And I was trying to think the way I did this. I think what I did is I took a stereo jack, plugged it into the tape recorder, and just ran that right into the phone, and it worked. The phone doesn't have an amplifier. So it was probably pretty faint now that I think about it, but I think that's how I did the technology in this. So this one, I used that same question that I used at Art Park. I was teaching at a university in Chicago at the time, and I sent my students out, and they had to go out and interview people who were waiting in line for something. So they could be waiting in line to get into a discotheque. They could be waiting in line to get into a homeless shelter. Food bank, those types of things. And they asked that same question, what do you think people should be thinking about? So I sort of had a sense of who that, you know, population of people were going to be and what the responses were. So I was kind of controlling the content a little bit more than I did in the other one. The piece was called Double Vision. You had it, two images, right? We all know what double vision is. All the images are, this guy was governor at, no, wait a minute. Paul Simon was, the guy with the glasses, was senator, I think the governor, and George Bush was in this too somewhere. So the president, so the idea was, here's George. So the idea was to kind of get a cross-section of the political people in place who control people's lives who are waiting in line to get into places. So that was fun, that was good. I think I got close to what I was after. Anybody recognize this guy? So this, keep in mind, this is where I pitch myself as a visionary. This was 1987, I think. And it was, that's the image of Robert Oppenheimer. And so I got, everybody seen Oppenheimer? Okay, good, because you haven't, go, just leave right now, go see it. Oppenheimer, like I got very interested in folk heroes and the kind of impact that they had on culture. And I'd gone from needing lists and statistical information to kind of figuring it out on my own. I discovered him. I don't know how I discovered him. Nobody knew anything about him at the time. Nobody had ever heard of him. And most people today probably hadn't heard of Oppenheimer until the movie came out, a great movie. I got these images of him. I studied up on him quite a bit, and I got these images of him throughout his life. So from a young boy to an old man. And, I hadn't photographed him. I basically steal everything, as you can tell at this point. Use it for my own good and then return it, I guess. Anyway, it was images of his whole life. So if you didn't know who Oppenheimer was, which most people probably didn't, you would come in and you would see a person's life all around the room. You know, it's kind of like, I don't know, you go to a funeral or something, and they have those books of people's, you know, different phases of the person's life who passed. And so that part of it I thought was kind of interesting. Because he had been so instrumental in our history and so instrumental in kind of trying to correct it, or sort of maintain the idea that we have atomic weapons after they dropped the atom bomb. I tried to sort of figure out the best way to, see, I got another picture here. The best way to juxtapose those images with a sound. And what I decided on was using a sound of endangered species, right? And so you can see back where that light is. There, the way I did this, you can kind of see it here, but the way I did this, and it goes back to this idea of embrace the visual qualities of the technology, right? In many cases, I'm putting them in boxes and hiding them. But I didn't really want to do that. I wanted people to see, oh, it's a tape recorder, you know, and it's probably a really cheap one. But anyway, I got these little terrariums, and I mounted them to the wall, and I put the tape recorder in the terrarium. Then it did the same thing. It just went up to the phone. Sometimes I used a thing that was called a tape loop, which came out of an answering machine. We used to have actual machines, can you believe it, that answer the phone? And so I had this, the tape loop would play something. I think the maximum amount of time was 6 minutes or something. So it would just loop for that. That's how I did the one at Art Park, the point of view piece. So this one, the audio in this, the endangered species, with this one it would be like the sound of a loon, which again, I cannot, can anybody do a loon call? So you're all from the Midwest. If you were from the East Coast, you could definitely do a loon call, but not me. It's just beautiful. That wasn't bad. That wasn't the way you do it, but that wasn't too bad. But so it added this, you know how sound does that, how it's so totally abstract, and that we respond to it on a very visceral level, right? Unless they're lyrics, I suppose. But if it's just the sound, there's just something magical that happens. So I thought that piece was pretty successful. Then I started to get better known for doing these projection pieces. And it kind of was the beginning of the end in a way for me, because the pieces got bigger. You can see here, I'm building these big, I built these big trusses. So you'd walk into an exhibit, the projection screens were double-sided projection screens. They were 20 feet high. This particular exhibit was in a space that was 6,000 square feet, right? This room here is probably 1,500, so it was immense, it was huge. And so it just got bigger and it got harder, but I wanted this to be really physical. This was a piece about philanthropy. I was teaching at a university that was funded by the tobacco industry, by R.J. Reynolds. And I thought that was kind of weird because tobacco kills people, you know, but they all thought that they should do something good for society. So they created Duke and Reynolds created universities. So I did this piece about philanthropy. Philanthropy is simply the science of giving. And I had these different areas because the space was so big and there were different things going on in different areas. So this was the kind of main area where there are big images of these philanthropists and some quotes by them. So it was kind of like it was a little bit like a history show, I think, to an example, to an extent. But another aspect of philanthropy is, because it really is about giving money, right? And we all give money through paying taxes. And also we do it through volunteering. So I found people in this town that I was living in at the time who volunteered. The mayor in the town, who's the woman on the left, didn't make enough money to pay for her transportation to conferences and things, police officer, of course. And then this woman over here was an artist, and I think there were six or seven of these people all together. And I went, I interviewed them. And it was really difficult for me because when you go and do something like that, these people are giving you, you know, hour of their time, hour of their life. I mean, the police officer had a child who died young, told me it's just an unbelievable story. And my original plan was to play 6 minute loops, which meant I would have had to edit those interviews from an hour down to 6 minutes. And that didn't feel right to me. So I got, you know, we could get, 60 minute tapes that we could play. And so the people who ran the museum had to go back and rewind after the tape had gotten to the end. And what I did with it was I got welcome mats. And for doing interactive stuff, it's a little bit tricky. I know you guys are learning to use Arduinos and movement sensors and stuff. Welcome mat, basically, what I did is I put an alarm sensor underneath it that they put under rugs. So if somebody broke it into your house and they stand on a rug, it connects two metal plates, sets off the alarm. So I used those, and when it connected the two plates, I think it turned on the speaker, not the I can't remember, because that is not somewhere I really think I would have wanted 110 volts if somebody's standing on top of it. So I think maybe it was probably like 12 volts to the speaker or something like that. But so people would stand there, and then they would listen to these volunteers tell the story. So it was kind of cool. This, again, I'm using, at this point in time, I'm still using this same system, projecting. This one is about Dante's Divine Comedy. Dante was a Renaissance poet, and he wrote this book about journeying through hell. And so I thought, oh, cool, you know, I'll do that. So I had a water element. So in the center there, I had sinks with dripping water. And I don't know. And plants. I had plants in it. I don't know what it was all about. There you see that. And then I had this. This was an interactive audio device, and this was the gates of hell. And in my vision of the gates of hell, I had, you see, Clinton on one side, and then Newt Gingrich, who was head of the Congress at the time, or the Senate, I can't remember. And they were, it's just like now, right? Where you have the Trump people and the Biden people, and they're like boom, boom, boom. So down the center of the corridor, the gate here, I don't know if you really see them, but I had movement sensors, which are the same movement sensors that you have on the outside of your house to turn your outside lights on. And those will power 110, that's what they do. They switch 110 volts to turn a light on. And so you can just as well plug a 110 supply in. And then I had these boxes on the outside, and they were big wooden boxes, and I didn't know any other way to do it, but they kind of operated like resonators. And they had, you know, all the stuff kind of hidden in there, the tape recorder. There might have been an amplifier in there. I think there was an amplifier in that case. And then a speaker. And the audio was them. On one side, it was Clinton. On the other side, it was Gingrich. And so there were four of these things. And as you walk through, you would turn one on, right? You pretty much understand that. And then you turn the other one on. And they were cross-talking at that point. Then you go a little bit farther and you turn the other two on, at which point it just was mush, right? Which was just exactly my interpretation of the political process at that point in time. This one, I'm gonna jump through this one here. This was one about Darwin, and I did lists of things. And you can't really see it, but in the middle there are little headphones. So the viewers had to put headphones on. And listen to, I think it was David Letterman's top 10 list, if any of you have ever heard that. If you haven't, Google it, these are real funny. So that was the Darwin piece. Then I had to give up all the projection stuff. The video projector had hit, every artist in the country was doing video projection work, and so I'm like, well, I don't want to do that anymore. So I started making furniture. I got two pieces from this whole suite of furniture that I made. I made what I thought was kind of high design furniture for lofts, because that's where high design furniture goes. And they had various forms of technology built into them, like the dining room table, for example, had computers. And these were real clunky computers. We used to have a warehouse out here where all the technology would go once faculty were done with it. So there were computers where you could email the other people at the dining room table, which at the time just seemed outrageous. And what had kind of piqued my curiosity was a story I'd read about some college students who were actually emailing people in the room next to them, asking them if they wanted to go get dinner. And you have no image of what that's like. I mean, now, you have no idea, because now, you know, you text the person sitting right next to you. I text my wife when, you know, we're eating dinner. We do this all the time. But then we had no idea what was going to happen with technology. So I made this thing that's called Love Seat, right? And a Love Seat today is basically a small couch. In the late 1800s, when the Victorians made love seats, they made them in sort of this S shape. So you can kind of see the S shape here. Starts here, goes around that way. The idea was that you could communicate with your lover, but you couldn't touch them, right? And that was bad in the Victorian world. So I made this one, which is basically two seats for the lovers. And it's got the steeple elements on it, you know, sort of symbolize marriage. And then it has phones on either side, a video camera, and a TV monitor. So what you would actually end up doing is sitting there and you would see, you know, your lover or whoever you were talking to on the other side of that wall and talking to him on the phone. And believe it or not, I mean, it was just unbelievable. People were starting to develop relationships. This is like the internet, let's see, yeah, it existed, but it was in its embryonic phase. People were starting to develop relationships over the phone. That's how, sort of in my mind, how kind of ridiculous technology, the direction that technology was heading. This piece, the next slide, I'll show you the video. This was the hearth in my designer loft. And the hearth used to be the place, you know, during the pioneer era, where the family would meet and have conversation, and oral history was passed down from one generation to the next, or they'd probably sing, play music and stuff. Once the television set arrived, whenever that was, 50s, early 60s or something, then that replaced the hearth. So no longer did that dialogue take place amongst the family. So I made this, I had these big lazy boy chairs that I made out of this wood, and you would sit there and you would watch. This was just a crazy video that I made, which I'll show you in a second. But the audio for this one was also the Buddhist monks sort of chanting. So it was really supposed to, in my mind, it was supposed to be about, let's see if it plays. It was supposed to be, you know, kind of a meditation. And this was, I spent a lot of time outdoors and the journey down the road was sort of about that kind of journey. It cycles over and over again. More water elements. Water is just, to me, the most amazing thing. So these were sculptures that had running water in them. In this case, it was, again, just a dripping snake. These were shown down in Lincoln at the Sheldon. This one has the sprinkler in the basement. This is sort of a cross-section of the Ogallala Aquifer, if you guys know what that is. This sprinkler would come on, and, you know, this had a movement sensor on it, so it would come on when people walked up to it. Museums don't like water. This one was interesting to me because what I really wanted to do was I wanted to use the oil drums as resonators, right? As y'all use resonators, I assume, probably all the time. And so they exist everywhere. I mean, this room is actually a great one. So I put the audio recording in the garbage, there it goes. Okay. So it's just the sounds of the birds, but it's really kind of beautiful sounds. Okay, are we about 5 minutes out, Seth?
Yep.
Okay. So I'm just going to run through the last couple of pieces. One of the things I do for my research is I find Roman roads and I document them. I hike them. I go to Italy and do that. It's like a good excuse to go to Italy. So in an attempt to try to make work about Roman roads, I made this piece. And when you do, like, you all know that feeling of discovery. You know, as artists, you have this probably all the time. But, you know, you play a scale writer, a songwriter, something, and you get this thrill that runs through your body. And what I wanted to do was create an earthquake. And so I got this, in this carton here, I put a tactile transducer. Does anybody know what that is? It's one of those things that people who play heavy bass in their cars put under their seats to make the car vibrate. Everybody familiar with that? So I put one of those on it. And so anytime anybody would come over and sit on this, it wasn't necessarily a noise as so much as it was a vibration. They do it in theaters too. It's pretty cool. And so they had to sit down, look through this telescope at a video that was across the room, was how I set that up. This is my most recent project. It's called Face of Another. It's based on a book by a Japanese author. And basically what I did was I ended up making these heads, and I'll go back for a second. I had a mold, and these were all hollow. What I wanted to do initially was I wanted to make a head, cut out an eye, and put a video in it. And that's all I wanted to do. But it took so long and so much work to do that, and I had this mold that I just started making heads. For the video, I used a Raspberry Pi program that I found on the internet, which will automatically loop any size video you want. If anybody wants to email me, I'll send you the link to it. It's really cool. They use it for conventions and stuff where they're playing video in the background. So, of course, thematically, everything was very complex here. So there's some audio. You'll see in the end, I do a walkthrough of this show. This is, I thought this was a video. Oh yeah, there it is. This was a piece called Consumption. It has a, it may not play here. Whoops. Anyway, it has a Arduino inside it using a relay that responds to pulse width modulation. That might be something you might come across. And what pulse width modulation is, when it switches something, it switches it softly as opposed to a regular switch, which is kind of like that. So it worked really well. And what it was a heartbeat. So the light flashed like a heartbeat. This one had a train going around through the head, so you'd hear the noise of the train. That one was fun. This one was the three, let's see if I can play this here. This was, had the recording. I thought if I just hit it. Oh, there it goes. So this one had the recording of the bunks, obviously singing in chords, right? And then you can see what I did with the technology is I have these MP3 players that you can just put a flash drive in, and it goes right into an amplifier that only costs $15. You can control the volume of these things much better with that. So then with the speakers, I just threw them on the floor. And definitely not the first person to do that. If you go back to Nam June Paik's work, you can see him doing that as well, that type of thing. A lot of technology in this one. This was a piece that was called Doubt, and it was based on this game that people play called Red Light, Green Light. Everything's just controlled with the Arduino, and then the audio, which is looping again with those same amplifiers, these little speakers are down right down in the corner there, is a man through a computer voice, say a male computer voice saying, no, I didn't, and yes, you did, no, I didn't, yes, you did. It's self-reflection. And then a woman's computer voice. Interesting maybe to see the technology. And then this one was called Synapse. Synapse is what you, this one actually was a mechanical relay. No, not gonna turn on. The mechanical relays click. And not gonna turn on. Okay, well, take that then. Let's see if this last video will play. I'd appreciate it if it did. Okay, this is the walkthrough. So this is the whole show. So what you get, you hear the monks in the background, then you hear the no you didn't, yes you did, no you didn't, then you hear the which is the synapse going on. So it's this kind of collage. What's the musical term for collage? Is there one? You know, there's just blending of all this sort of chaotic stuff. In addition to, there you see the, oh, we just passed it, the head which had the video in it, with all this stuff kind of going on simultaneously. All right, 1 minute out here. I'm gonna stop it just in case somebody has a question. No question, yeah.
Have you been in touch with any of the alien videotape piece from when you had the hour long interviews?
With what?
Have you been in touch with any of those people?
No. That was years ago. But that's an interesting question. And when I lived with that family in Nepal, I never stayed in touch with them either. I'm bad at that.
And where did you retrieve your monk recordings?
Internet. I think I just, there are a lot of them out there. And sometimes what I'll do is now with you guys, the files exist, right? And sometimes I will record them. Like I'll record stuff when I'm playing it through a system on a separate recorder, but that's a pretty good quality one. So I'm pretty sure I downloaded that, maybe a YouTube video or something. Do you guys talk about copyright issues at all? Is that a concern? Was that kind of where you're headed with that question?
No, I was just saying, like, if it was something that you recorded from, like, live.
It would be amazing to record it live.
Yeah, that's
yeah, because you get, there's so much other stuff going on these are sort of monasteries, so they're designed for sound. Mm. It would be amazing. That'd be worth going back to do that. Yeah.
What future projects do you have planned out?
Well, I'm going to retire in May. And the drawback from doing this work is I never sold anything. So I funded it. Seth read off some of those places where I got grants. I funded it through teaching here, partially, and getting grants. When I was in Chicago and showing in New York, it was much easier, much more money for artists. And then it just gets hard. These are big pieces. Even transporting them is extremely expensive for somebody at my level. You know, if you're at the level of Jeff Koons or somebody like that, it's no problem. But I think the last piece that was transported to Charlotte, North Carolina, the transportation, or no, it was St. Louis, transportation costs were like $6,000-$7,000. And so it just gets really, really hard to do the work. You have to have studio space. For a long time, I had a big studio downtown. I don't have that anymore. So, it just got too hard to do it. So what I'm thinking of doing is making some money. So I have all these skills, right? I mean, I can do, I suppose I could do audio editing with some program. But, you know, I can do 3D modeling. I can do drafting. I teach sculpture here. So I can build stuff, and I love building stuff, and I love objects. And so what I'm thinking of doing is creating some kind of sort of design fabrication business. But whatever I do, I want to, you know, I don't want a pat on the back anymore. I want the green stuff. That's how shallow I become. I don't respond to people who have given me this valuable information, and I just want money.